Armstrong dispatches tonight who really runs British boxing. In the ring, it looks like being a vintage year. For the first time this century, there's a British-born world heavyweight champion in Lennox Lewis. There's even the chance of a fight between Lewis and the ever-popular Frank Bruno. But for tonight's dispatch, boxing writer and fight advisor Jonathan Rendell reveals the real story of who wins and loses in British boxing. What price fair play in The Fight Game?
To an outsider, the world of professional boxing is a highly competitive business, with boxers, managers and promoters all fighting to land the big prizes. But all is not as it seems. For much of the post-war era, British boxing was dominated by two businessmen, Mickey Duff and Jarvis Astaire. Their syndicate operated a virtual monopoly over the sport. The 1980s were supposed to be the time when the business was opened up to fair competition. But today, it seems that old habits are dying hard. Five key areas make up the jigsaw puzzle of the boxing business. The boxers, the men who take the knocks and draw the audiences. The press, where favorable publicity is vital for selling tickets. Television, the generator of cash that keeps boxing alive. The venues, having ready access to top venues can give a promoter a decisive advantage. The British Boxing Board of Control. Under its General Secretary, John Morris, the board has the power to destroy or advance any boxer's career at the stroke of a pen. The Board of Control's constitution means it's accountable only to itself. This investigation questions the consistency of its decisions taken behind closed doors. In particular, we inquire into its dealings with this man, matchmaker Mickey Duff, and his financial partner Jarvis Astaire.
Our influence has been a benevolent one. It may not suit you to hear that, but it's true. And as a result of it, people who we'd have been associated with have benefited.
You've made me a target. And my associates are targets. And I don't give a fuck because you are not going to find nothing at all because we genuinely do nothing wrong and never have. So I don't give a fuck how much you go around.
Mickey Duff and I, and people we're associated with, and Terry Lawless, for example, have been involved in boxing for a long time. We have stood the test of time. We have always conducted our business in a proper manner.
Professional boxing has always been as much a business as a sport. Franklin Roy Bruno is Astaire and Duff's most lucrative product yet. His two world title defeats grossed millions. Now he's on the verge of a third money-spinning challenge. But who supplies most of Bruno's opponents, and how real are those contests? Introducing Johnny Boss.
Basically, what I do is I provide a service for promoters all over the world. Promoters overseas would be looking for somebody to fight their fighter. Somebody maybe on even terms or just a little bit less than even or would give the local fighter a bit of an edge.
Johnny Boss is known as the Gravedigger, and he is Mickey Duff's American agent.
My agent, Johnny Boss,
yeah.
Who I would trust almost with my life. He's the only one. Mm. He's the only one in the whole of the United States that I would take a fighter unseen from. If he says to me, a guy is okay, that means in his opinion he can't win at all. He has no chance of winning.
Yeah.
And those kind of matches I rely on him for when I don't want to take any chances at all, when a kid's on his way up.
He's known as finding good bodies for you in the business, and he's proven it over the years. Through him they've built Frank Bruno.
Over the last 10 years, Boss has earned an international reputation for finding the perfect opponent.
Perfect opponent. You'd have to say somebody that's going to walk to you, that's not a big puncher, that's easy to hit with a good chin. Right?
Can you make a fortune with a stable of guys like that?
Hell, if you had a... Yeah, but see, they'd have to win once in a while.
A reformed alcoholic, Boss knows all the fighters who are credible, but not too exacting. Fighters who are perhaps semi-retired, broke, or even alcoholic. Johnny Boss knows them all, and is able to send a steady supply to clients such as Mickey Duff, who uses him frequently. Bruno's career represents a series of high-stakes domino games, a series of fights leading to a world heavyweight title fight, the payday. Duff and Astaire negotiate the payday. To get to it, Johnny Boss lines up the dominoes for Bruno to knock over. Each fight is designed to increase Bruno's reputation and pulling power. Then, whether Bruno wins or loses the title fight, Duff and Astaire cash in.
I do work a lot with Mickey Duff. I understand that throughout Frank Bruno's career, you have provided many opponents for Frank.
Yeah, more than a handful.
Yeah. How did that relationship originally begin?
Well, I was working with Mickey for 5 years before Bruno was around.
Uh-huh. We have a list of Bruno opponents that you've booked. What I'd like you to do, if you can, tell me a little bit about the opponent and, you know, what happened and how you felt about that as the man that booked him in. I think you booked Lupe Guerrera, Bruno's debut. Tell us about Lupe.
Perfect opponent. Had a good built-up record, was like 16-6. Had fought many 10-round fights already, but was too small to do anything against Frank. And when he's, I think, once Frank walked out there and blasted him, he more than had enough.
But you knew that going in.
That he would go one round?
Well, that he didn't have much of a chance of winning.
If he had much of a chance of winning, he wouldn't have been in there.
Now, here's a guy that didn't give Bruno much of a go at all, Bill Sharkey. He went out and won.
Well, Bill Sharkey at that time had seen better days.
Now, here's a fellow that was famous for biting in the clinches.
Jumbo Cummings.
Oof.
Jumbo nearly upset everything. Come out to hit Frank Bruno. I believe it was a right hand in the first round, right at the bell. And they tell me Terry Lawless made a hell of a catch.
How about Phil the Pacifist Brown? Lasted 10 rounds with Bruno. The first of the Johnny Boss opponents that we've mentioned that actually went the distance.
Might have been the last. did anybody else go the distance I sent over there? Geez, that was a mistake.
The ever-popular Chuck Gardner, who went out and one round in France against Bruno, supplied by you. What can you tell us about good old Chuck?
Let me tell you something. Chuck Gardner could box a little bit. Was it?
When?
No, believe me. I just didn't know the guy was on a binge when he went over there. That was embarrassing. You know, out of all the guys I've ever sent over for Bruno, if there was one I could take back, it would definitely be Chuck Gardner.
It's too late now.
Yeah. I think he's died of old age.
There is no evidence to suggest that Bruno knew anything about the way his opponents were selected or had even met Johnny Boss. It is largely through Boss that Bruno's 12-year career has been brilliantly, if cynically, sustained by Duff. But the making of boxers like Frank Bruno began long before Bruno was even born. Back in the East End of London after the war, Mickey Duff was one of hundreds of young boxers trying to make a name in the toughest business of all. Duff's real name is Morris Pragier. He was born in Krakow and comes from a Polish family of rabbis. But Duff was not destined for a religious calling. He changed his name after seeing a film featuring a character called Boy Duffy. Today, he is established as one of the most powerful matchmakers in the business. He started out as a teenage drifter and gambler.
He used to stay in billiard halls and billiard clubs and this type of thing, you know? And he was almost like a cuckoo. He used to go into most people's homes at that stage. But that was his life. I mean, he loved to gamble and he loved to box.
Gamble on cards or boxing or?
Gamble on anything. Two flies up a wall, as they say, proverbially.
I don't have to help you investigate me. You make sure you have it well and truly recorded. Well and truly recorded.
So you won't agree to being interviewed by me?
Pardon?
You wouldn't agree to being interviewed
Why
by me?
Why would I agree to be interviewed by a prick like you? What reason do you have to investigate me or my associates?
For this program, Mickey Duff declined to be interviewed. Jarvis Astaire is the son of emigrants from Russia. His real name is Joseph Golombovich. His father was a cabinet maker in the East End. These days, Astaire is a winner, a successful tycoon with powerful friends.
There's a chance of this fight in America. There's no object in you defending the European Championship when you've got the chance of fighting your...
He's a man with a web of business interests involving dozens of companies on and offshore. He's a member of the MCC and a high-profile charity worker. From the beginning, Jarvis supplied the contacts, the legal expertise and financial muscle. Mickey was the matchmaking genius who knew the good prospects and the fighters to avoid. It was the ideal partnership to take on British boxing, despite early setbacks. Mickey Duff was convicted for illegal gambling while he was still a boxer. It resulted in his board license being withdrawn. It was some time before he was allowed back into the game as a matchmaker. Dispatches has obtained a document stating that Jarvis Astaire also had his license withdrawn in 1948 by the board's Southern Area Council, then controlled by the legendary promoter Jack Solomons.
Well, I mean, not only was it widely known, it just could not be believed at that stage that Jarvis, who was almost the rising star in competition to the Solomons dynasty, that here he was banned from holding a promoter's license.
Was your license ever withdrawn?
No. No. Never withdrawn.
Can I show you...
Solomons made attempts to withdraw it, but it was never withdrawn.
It's from the Board of Records.
What does it say?
It says license withdrawal.
No, no, Southern Area Council was renewed. Southern Area Council, each time they did it, Solomons did it. It was always renewed on appeal. Always.
We asked the British Boxing Board of Control to clarify the question of Jarvis Astaire's license. The board replied, "We are unable to assist you." Whatever the circumstances concerning the apparent withdrawal of Jarvis Astaire's license, he has held a promoter's license in his own name since the end of the 1980s.
Mick had started up matchmaking at small shows throughout the East End, and Jarvis recognised his talents because, love him or hate him, he's a very talented boxing person. He was very good at his job. And Jarvis recognised this.
Their first real chance came with the middleweight Terry Downs. Astaire was his manager. Within 2 years, Downs, by now the number one ticket seller in Britain, had put Duff and Astaire on the boxing map. But soon another fighter they were involved with became an even bigger draw, Billy Walker. Mickey Duff was matchmaker for Walker's fight, while Astaire shared in the promotional profits. Walker was the prototype Bruno, a brave but limited boxer. The use of Walker showed how fights could be marketed to a new television audience of millions who knew little about boxing but wanted to see knockouts. At the same time, Duff and Astaire's syndicate had been established through a loyal network of managers and exclusive access to the two major London venues, the Albert Hall and Wembley. Duff and Astaire's domination of British boxing was all but sewn up. But the heavyweights are where the money is. And despite their success with Walker, Astaire and Duff's influence on the game had one big obstacle, Henry Cooper. Independent and outside the syndicate, Cooper had beaten Billy Walker and killed their golden goose.
Anybody that was an individual, independent type, will always be a thorn in Mickey's side.
In the late 60s, though, the syndicate found a new heavyweight, Joe Bugner. He was superbly athletic and had talent.
10 seconds.
The crunch fight came when Bugner took on Cooper at Wembley on March the 16th, 1971.
And there it is. It's over. And Cooper gives him a pat.
The verdict of referee Harry Gibbs in awarding the fight to Bugner was, and still is, regarded by many people as the most controversial decision in all the 30 years that Mickey Duff and Jarvis Astaire have been at the top of the boxing business. But it didn't matter. Henry Cooper was out of the way for good.
And how in the world can you take away the man's three titles like that?
Mark McCormick has been asked to see me for a few days. I saw him last night. He signed up for Ali.
With Bugner's victory and Cooper defeated, Astaire and Duff had a product to export to the American market. A Bugner-Muhammad Ali non-title fight followed, then Bugner v. Joe Frazier, Ali Bugner for the title. In 15 short years, Duff and Astaire had become international high rollers on the boxing scene.
Madison Square Garden.
Duff and Astaire began to be cut in as partners in the promotional revenues from big American fights. But what about the British commodities they were trading in? The fighters themselves.
Hey, Gil.
Mickey, we're waiting. We're waiting for you.
The helicopters are slower than the buses.
Joe Bugner now lives a comfortable life in Australia, but he says he owes it not to Duff and Astaire, but to his wife, Marlene, who managed him after he had left the syndicate.
I won't write it, you can write it.
It's something you reflect back on and you say, God, these bastards really had me, because again, he was the goose that was laying all these big eggs and somebody else was getting all the dough.
We have always conducted our business in a proper manner. Boxers who are associated with us and everything else are still on an extremely good relationship with us.
Jarvis Astaire made special mention to dispatches of the good relationships he and Mickey Duff maintain with their boxers. But like Bugner, other boxers we spoke to who fought more recently for the syndicate did not appear to agree.
I feel like I've been used and abused in this boxing game.
I feel so stupid talking about it now as a man. Okay, my naivety and innocence and plain stupidity really as a fighter. But money was the last thing that was mentioned, ever.
And here we are, pro fighters in the hardest game in the world, second to none. You're getting in that ring, laying everything on the line, and you don't know what you're getting. And when you do get it, you are gutted.
During that time, I had never ever seen a license for televising of my fights. I've never seen a contract for that. I've never seen a radio contract. I've never seen an advertising contract. I've never seen a gate receipt, okay? And I had like nearly 50 fights with these people.
But how can you agree on an all-in deal when you don't know what the separate parts of the deal are going to add up to?
Because we're naive, ignorant, stupid, godsend for the promoters.
You say to him anything about money, and that is a touchy subject.
Yeah.
That's when you see the true colours of where they're coming from.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, they're like wolves in sheep's clothing, you know?
Such fighters should have their interests defended by one body, the British Boxing Board of Control. All power emanates from the board. It controls every aspect of the game. The board used to be elected regionally by people in the business, promoters, managers and boxers. But in 1960, in the key southern area region that contained the big London venues, that system was abandoned on a vote. It later emerged that Jarvis Astaire and Mickey Duff had been lobbying behind the scenes for a system they preferred.
When do you think it dawned on people in boxing just how important that vote would turn out to be?
Well, I think when they realised that nobody was consulted at all about the constitution of the new council. Nobody was consulted about anybody who was going to sit on there. And I think they realised right away they made a mistake.
Since then, it has been a self-appointed body, composed of men with no financial interest in the sport. They have a duty to guarantee fair play and impartiality. The board's letterhead boasts two judges, seven QCs, four doctors, and the man who arrested the craze. In reality, most of these eminent people have little, if anything, to do with the day-to-day decision-making at the board. That duty resides primarily with the board's general secretary. For much of the 1970s and 80s, the position was held by Ray Clark, now OBE. In 1986, he was succeeded as General Secretary by John Morris. Nowhere will you find Astaire and Duff on the letterhead, but some of their competitors believe their names might as well be at the top.
There's no point in complaining about Mickey Duff to the British Boxing Board, that's my belief.
Why not?
I don't think you can win.
They seem to lean, or not seem to, they do lean towards Duff and Astaire. Any hearing you go to, they always seem to command a lot of respect from the
stewards, and they also seem to control the meetings.
Because we have been successful, then under those circumstances, we've had influence, obviously. But I think it's only, as I've said before, it's only the have-nots who complain about the haves.
It would indeed be a matter of concern if the decisions of the board were influenced by people with a vested interest. In 1988, Mickey Duff attempted to speak for the board at an international boxing convention in Jamaica. Al Hamilton, a journalist, was present.
Mickey Duff got up and said, "I will speak on behalf of the board." Walked up towards the chair. And it just basically showed that Duff felt that he was big enough. But I, being whether he was friendly with these people at the board, or whether he felt, "Well, listen, I am Mickey Duff, and, you know, I'm next to God Almighty," whatever his motives were, he got up and he overruled the two people who were there as representatives of British Boxing Board of Control, which was astonishing.
The same year, Jarvis Astaire again appeared to speak for the board. He told an American TV network that the board would not sanction a rival promoter's world title fight. Astaire had in his possession confidential documents that the promoter had earlier lodged at the board. The promoter made a strong protest. The board apologized.
I've got a letter of an apology, and they tried to justify it, but there was no justification for that at all. You know, Jarvis Astaire should not be in possession of any confidential correspondence between myself and the board. It's outrageous.
Other Boxing Board of Control decisions have led to bizarre, unfair, and in some cases potentially dangerous anomalies. In part two, we examine a trail which goes back a long way, over 20 years.
It's not the Boxing Board of Control, it's the Boxing Board of No Control.
One person who's concerned about the Boxing Board of Control is Eddie Thomas. In the 60s and 70s, Thomas managed arguably Britain's finest post-war fighter, the lightweight Ken Buchanan. Eddie Thomas remained outside the syndicate. When Buchanan became British champion, his world potential was evident. When Buchanan's contract finished, Eddie Thomas was called to a meeting at the board. Mickey Duff and his associates claimed Buchanan wanted to go with them. Thomas felt the purpose of the meeting seemed to be to question his fitness to manage Buchanan.
Certain people wanted Buchanan in their camp, and they came to the board. Now, I had a man representing me there that day called Victor Durand, one of the finest QCs in the land. And he said, "There's a very bad smell in this room today of an attempt to take a man's character away from him."
Thomas was shocked to learn that there had been an unofficial approach made to Buchanan from a supposedly impartial source, encouraging him to join Duff and Astaire.
Well, Buchanan said to me that an official from the boxing board had spoken to him.
Dispatches has learnt that the man in question was Ray Clark, OBE, then the general secretary of the board.
Ray Clark, yes, spoke to Ray.
Did Ray Clark offer any opinion as to where you would be better off?
Well, not really, but we did talk. It probably would have been better off if I'd been with them. With the higher rolling shows like, you know, Wembley, Albert Hall and that, with, you know, Mickey Duff and so forth.
Jarvis Astaire does not see anything wrong with Clark's unofficial intervention.
What do you think an outsider would think of a supposedly impartial official of the board acting like that?
I think it's a perfectly reasonable thing for him to do. I know, for example, that there are people on the Boxing Board of Control who from time to time recommend boxers to go with Mickey Duff. I know that. That's a fact.
Eddie Thomas's refusal to tie his fighter up with Duff and Astaire meant that Buchanan, further, was denied the chance of boxing at the top venues they then had exclusive contracts with. The best prospect in Britain was forced to box in members-only dinner clubs.
They were saying could be done about it, and I had to suffer, so that's why I packed up. I mean, a lot of people don't know that. I mean, you're one of the few that have actually asked me about that. I did pack up. The people in the street don't know that Ken Buchanan actually packed up boxing and handed his Lonsdale belt back to the Board of Control in 1969.
Buchanan went on to win the world lightweight title in 1970. Despite worldwide acclaim for Buchanan, the British Board of Control initially refused to recognise him as champion and threatened to strip Buchanan and Thomas of their licences. But soon afterwards, there was to be a new figure managing Buchanan's affairs, in Jarvis Astaire. And Buchanan says the board's attitude towards him underwent a radical change.
So you found, really, that that once you'd made this career move and changed camps, your problems with the board seemed to evaporate.
Yeah, there was no deal. We didn't really have any problems with that at all, like, you know what I mean?
When it comes to medical matters, the board's rules are all-powerful, so it is all the more important that they are consistent and beyond reproach. But it is in this, the medical arena, that the board's decisions have been most disturbing. Disquieting rumours have been circulating in boxing for several years that with the full knowledge of a senior board official, an overseas boxer was allowed to box on a Mickey Duff promotion while suffering from a potentially lethal skull condition. Dispatches can reveal that the boxer in question was an American heavyweight named Oscar Holman. In 1984, Frank Warren arranged a match for Holman in London, but it never came off.
When Holman arrived in the country, he had a skull x-ray test, which the board insists that all boxers should have, foreign boxers that is, prior to a fight in this country. And the report said he had thinness of the skull, which meant really he couldn't fight.
The death of another boxer with a thin skull in 1982 had led the board to introduce compulsory skull x-rays, such as this one. The doctor who examined Holman forwarded a copy of his report to the British Boxing Board of Control. 2 years later, Gary Mason, a heavyweight promoted by Mickey Duff, fought an eight-round contest in Wolverhampton. His opponent, Oscar Holman. By now, John Morris had taken over from Ray Clark as General Secretary of the Boxing Board of Control.
But they allowed him to box, which I found very strange. In fact, I rang John Morris and asked him why, seeing as that, you know, I knew he had a thinness of the skull.
Did you ring him before the fight or after the
fight? Before the fight.
Despite having a damning medical report, and in spite of Warren's advance warning, John Morris, the board secretary, allowed Oscar Holman's fight on a Mickey Duff promotion to go ahead. When contacted by dispatches, John Morris said he had no knowledge of the Holman affair. However, dispatches has obtained tape-recorded evidence. In it, Morris told a license holder who wishes to remain anonymous that he would find out who had passed Holman fit to box.
You know what went on before where the guy failed his skull x-ray, don't you? And, you know, he was allowed to box.
Who's
it? One of Mason's opponents. It'd be interesting to find out who actually, perhaps you'd like to look up who actually passed him. Do you want to phone up Royal Northern Hospital? That's where he failed his skull x-ray.
Mm-hmm. I remember some discussion about it.
In 1991, Frank Bruno had decided to make a comeback, and the boxing world fully expected him to return with a rival promoter, Barry Hearn. Then, Bruno was discovered to have a torn retina. Under board rules, this would stop him from fighting, except with the board's special dispensation. At this point, Bruno switched promoters and signed with Mickey Duff. Shortly afterwards, the board gave him back his license to box.
The cynic would say, I suppose, that he could have thought it was an easier ride to a license if he was with Mickey Duff rather than someone quite new like me. And I don't know whether that's true or not.
In 1990, Gary Mason had also suffered a retina injury. The board, sticking by its rules, would not reissue his license. Then Mickey Duff contacted him. At a meeting, Mason remembers Duff putting a proposition to him.
I would do everything to help you get your license back if you come with me. If you go against me, I will do everything within my power to stop you from getting your license back.
Mason signed a contract with Duff.
And then I was given clearance to box again. And that was without actually visiting the board any time and sitting down and having a meeting with them.
Mason only had one more fight against Lennox Lewis. He suffered further severe retina damage and could have been blinded. In the mid-1980s, a front-page story in the Sunday Times shocked the boxing world. The Insight team discovered a document, the so-called Cartel Agreement, revealing that Terry Lawless, Britain's leading and purportedly independent manager, had in fact for years been an undisclosed signatory to a profit-sharing agreement with Mickey Duff and Jarvis Astaire. A question was tabled in the House of Commons, but but the board exonerated the parties concerned.
Far from being against the interests of boxing, it is considered that without their very active participation, then boxing in this country would not be in as healthy a state as it is now.
The famous whitewash. The board inquiry, as one might have predicted, ended up, as one boxing writer said, in giving them not a ticking off but a round of applause. It had no effect whatsoever, nor did I imagine for a moment that it would.
Well, I would commend you to the declaration of the stewards of the Boxing Board of Control, who held a two-day inquiry, and I believe that if that inquiry was to take place today, the Board of Control would express their views in exactly the same way.
To cynics of their decision, the board pointed to testimonies from boxers that they were happy with their management. But for the first time, dispatches can reveal the circumstances in which some of the fighters gave their endorsements to their manager, Terry Lawless.
They come to us saying, look, I'm banging trouble, the papers are going to stitch me up, or they're going to write a load of lies about me, and you'll find out what it's about Sunday. We never had a clue what he was talking about. All we knew was that this fellow that we trusted was banging trouble, and if we signed this bit of paper, it'd magically get him out of trouble, right? I never knew what I was signing. I signed it along with the rest of them.
Everyone signed it then?
Yeah, everyone signed it, and on what we've done, we exempted him from any blame.
Nick Pitt of the Sunday Times is just one of a number of prominent boxing journalists to have been banned from covering Mickey Duff's promotions.
When I went into boxing journalism, I supposed that the idea of being a journalist was to find out what was going on and then tell the public about it. But when I tried to do that in practice, I became rather unpopular.
They banned boxing news. That about says it. The Bible, the thing that, the entity that people look on as the ultimate in boxing. They've had the timidity to ban people for writing what they felt like. They did as they please. Full stop.
While the press is helpful, television is crucial. Particularly the BBC. While any promoter can bid for fight dates on ITV, such does not seem to have been the case with the BBC, which over the years has devoted a far greater amount of airtime to boxing. Of 199 promotions over 16 years that we could find in the BBC archives, only four did not involve the syndicate.
Oh yes, we've had a contractual relationship with the BBC ongoing for well over 30 years. I do the deals with the BBC, and the simple fact is that they like to stick with us because we deliver.
But the question most often asked is, how can other promoters hope to deliver when the BBC almost always says no to their promotions?
How many shows have you had on television?
I think approximately 300.
And how many of those have been on the BBC?
Two. Since 1987... In one form or the other, around 160.
And how many of those have been on the BBC?
Two.
And what reason do they give for not taking the fights?
They told me they'd been getting good service from Mickey Duff, but he'd always delivered, and maybe I was just a one-off, and they didn't want to damage their relationship.
Either they haven't got the slots, or the money's committed elsewhere, or the fight doesn't appeal to them.
Was there any other reason ever given?
That's the on record, off the record, I've been told from other people at BBC that they're committed to Jarvis, Astaire and Mickey Duff shows.
The cake is not shared round and is not even available. In reality, we all know that you may offer, but you may as well offer to a deaf man.
While it might be argued that rival promoters have a vested interest in criticising the BBC's boxing policy, the raw statistics do not tell the whole story. Dispatches have seen documents which suggest that the BBC's boxing schedule is built around Astaire and Duff promotions without even knowing who will be boxing. Even if they wanted to take other people's fights, there simply wouldn't be room. This has led to frequent accusations that the syndicate has a virtually exclusive entry to the BBC, an accusation Jarvis Astaire denies.
We're not exclusive. We don't prevent anybody else or the BBC doing business with anybody else. There's nothing about our arrangements with them which precludes them from dealing with anybody else, and they do deal with other people. They just, I think, when it comes to certain aspects, prefer to deal with us. That's all.
This access to the BBC enables Duff and Astaire to underwrite the cost of promotions in advance. The BBC gives them a huge advantage over their competitors, but not always to the advantage of the BBC. In 1984, the corporation paid £20,000 to screen Bruno versus Phil Brown. The bout was so dull it was never even screened. In 1987, it paid in excess of £60,000 for Bruno versus the grossly out of condition Chuck Gardner in Cannes. The fight lasted 40 seconds, or at least £1,500 a second of licence payers' money. In 1991, for the first round fiasco against Dutch barkeeper John Emmon, the BBC fee to Duff and Astaire was in excess of £150,000.
You have had to survive some fairly heavy criticism at the time of matches like the Chuck Gardner fight and the John Emmon fight.
Yes.
In retrospect, were they mistakes?
No. Bruno won each one. He's got an audience of nearly 13 million on television the other night. So how can they be mistakes?
Of all the fighters that you book as opponents, what would you say is the percentage of those that spring an upset?
Hard to say. I never looked at it.
Give us a ballpark figure.
I hope it's not too good.
If it was too good,
I'd probably be out of a job.
Jarvis Astaire told us the deal with the BBC worked both ways.
And when you say we've had the benefit, they've had the benefit of what we've provided them with. And they're very, very happy with it, obviously. That's why they keep on with us.
License payers may therefore find it all the more surprising that not one of Bruno's three biggest fights was shown live on the BBC. Bruno's first world title fight against Tim Witherspoon in 1986 was shown live on ITV. The Bruno Bugner fight of 1987 was shown live on ITV. And Bruno's second world title shot against Mike Tyson was shown live on Sky. Once again, only the Board of Control is in the position to regulate the fair distribution of TV dates among promoters.
And if the Board of Control wouldn't have televised, wouldn't have approved, that would have been the end of it. And our contract with the Board of with the BBC has always contained a clause which says, provided the contest that we show is authorised by the British Boxing Board of Control.
Dispatches asked the BBC's head of sport, Jonathan Martin, to comment on the BBC's policy on the use of Jarvis Astaire's and Mickey Duff's promotions. Jonathan Martin has not replied to our requests. But Jarvis Astaire's competitors believe his and Duff's relationship with the BBC is the clincher that, with the board's cooperation, sustains the syndicate's power regardless of what the competition does. For the last 30 years, the central question in British boxing has been, who controls it? The answer should be the British Boxing Board of Control.
This cartel, the Boxing Board of Control, or as a lot of people call it, the Boxing Board out of control, should be investigated. I think there should be some sort of governmental ombudsman, you name it, whatever you want to call it.
Money for boxers was something that the board never took any interest in whatsoever. They would sometimes give lip service to the welfare of boxers. They would sometimes, under pressure, look into the medical aspects of the sport and improve those. But they would never, ever look at what was really important for boxers, which was the money they were getting.
And it's got worse, and it's slowly deteriorated until now. Because they just don't control. They should change their name to British Boxing Board of Administration. They're no longer the British Boxing Board of Control. They control nothing.
Today, as before, competitors of Mickey Duff and Jarvis Astaire believe that as far as British boxing is concerned, it remains business as usual.
They have major influence over certain sections of the tabloid press. They are the sole promoters at Wembley. They have, I believe, major influence over the Boxing Board of Control. And the bottom line of that, it means that boxing, promoters, boxers, everybody in it, are still suffering.
I feel ashamed for some people in power that
should have put a stop to this long ago. And I think the Boxing Board of Control are the number one. They should have said this is not happening. Everybody's got to have a fair share.